most of you guys don't know, outside of talking and obsessing about the art market, I also manage visual artists and I'm an art advisor.
She's bossy.
Hey, I'm not that bossy, but Lamont has been gracious enough to take a chance on me. And as he says, I'm taking the chance on him. Lamont was working on his upcoming exhibition Fuego for nearly a year and a half. Like everyone, he was quarantined. To both of our risk, I sat and watched him make most of the work for Fuego in preparation of curating the show. When I curate, I like to be close to the work and close to the artist.
When it comes down to who I am, the core of me is, like I always say, is I'm just a Creole kid from Houston.
So this is an exhibition that Lamont has been working on for the past year and a half. And I've had the pleasure of actually sitting with him and seeing him working on most of the pieces from start to finish. But Lamont, I want them to hear a little bit about who you are.
Ann Arbor, Michigan, where my dad's originally from.
Right.
And that's actually where, at the time, I wasn't happy because I was a young kid. I was 9 years old when we moved, and coming from the big city and my family being here, as far as my mother's side, I felt like I was uprooted and out of place. But we lived there for 5 years, so we moved back to Houston when I was 13. So that's actually where I learned about culture and aesthetic of art and theater. Also, too, I started to speak a second language, which was French and German.
So when you say that, I've heard you say that a few times, and when you say that, I'm always surprised that you've learned, like, you got a lot of your culture from Michigan.
Well, what people have to understand is that Ann Arbor, Michigan.
Nothing against Michigan. We're just Texas, Louisiana. So, it's very surprising to me that Michigan, you know.
But the thing is, so my father directly grew up in Ann Arbor, Michigan.
Yeah.
So Ann Arbor, Michigan is not a really big town, but it's a college town. It's where the University of Michigan is.
Yeah.
So the town is super small to the point to where I could ride my bicycle from the east side of town to the west side of town.
Yeah, like Beaumont, exactly. Like where I'm from.
Exactly.
Yeah,
It reminds me of, a small town like that.
Yeah.
But the entire town is the University of Michigan.
Yeah.
So I was going to elementary school with kids from Russia, and my best friend, his parents were from Hungary.
Yeah.
I remember specifically going to school, being in the fourth grade, going to school with a kid who was directly from India.
Yeah.
And he wore the red dot on his forehead, and in the wintertime, it would be snow on the ground
because
we're up north, but he would be in a full winter coat, hat, everything, pants, and he would have on sandals. So also, too,
Lamont, I want them to hear a little bit about who you are.
Athletics. So when I lived there, that's when the infamous Fab Five had come to town, and, with Chris Webber, Jalen Rose, Juwan Howard, Jimmy King and Ray Jackson are actually they're from Texas.
Yeah.
So I was familiar.
I'm not going to lie to you.
You don't know who
those are? I don't know who those people are. Yeah.
Well, but from a culture standpoint, they kind of shifted and changed the culture, not just of college basketball, but basketball period with, that's when they were the first ones to wear baggy shorts and to wear black socks and black shoes.
Okay.
For political premise, because they felt like the university was making money off of them.
Yeah.
And, they wore bald heads and they were making millions and millions of dollars for the university, but they were still getting racist letters written to them. And Nike and the university was making money off of them, but they were still broke.
Yeah.
So that was like their political outcry to say, like, this is what we're going to do.
Yeah.
As the backlash, that was their statement. But these guys were, at the time, they were 18, 19 years old.
Yeah, doing that.
Yeah, and even to be conscious enough to do that. And then, this is in 1991, 92.
Yeah.
So that's also, too, when, Public Enemy was starting to be prevalent in hip-hop music, N.W.A., Tupac, things like that. But I'm in the midst of, this culture, I would say this culture tornado, because also, too, how the town is split, as far as for the residents, is that most of the white kids, it's an expensive place because it's ran by the university. So most of the white kids lived in like a neighborhood or in a house with their parents, and all of the lower end, or what they called at the time Section 8, the black people, they lived in the projects.
Yeah.
People wouldn't think that in a college town there were projects, but there were. There was two on each side of town.
Yeah.
So going to school, my parents were a little bit more affluent. So we lived in a neighborhood. So most of my neighborhood friends from when I went to elementary school, they were white. Mm-hmm. And then when I got to middle school, it was a big melting pot.
Yeah.
But everyone kind of chose sides.
Yeah, of course.
You know, so.
Yeah.
but I have white friends. Yeah. But then also, too, I have these black friends that I'm just now meeting. And, you know, it was kind of a divide to where, you know, the blacks thought that I felt like I was too white. And then my white friends, they just didn't really understand why I didn't hang out with them anymore.
Yeah.
But it was almost to the point to where, you know, it was.
You started to find comfort.
That's the thing. It was a little bit more uncomfortable
with the black kids because you were so accustomed to growing up. So I want to roll back just a little bit, right? Because what they don't know, what I know, is that your work is context heavy. Like there's so much context that mm-hmm. goes into your work. Mm-hmm. And what I want them to understand is that how you take all of these things that you've absorbed, I mean, from to the smallest detail, mm-hmm. and you dig into it, mm-hmm. and then you put it in your work. Uh-huh. And I've seen you go from these thoughts, these actually like simple thoughts that I don't have a grasp on, and then you elaborate on its historical context, how it relates to the present, mm-hmm. and how it could be relevant in the future, and you put these things into your paintings. And so I want them to understand before you start going into like all of these different things, I want them to understand that you've taken these experiences and mm-hmm. you've layered them throughout all of your works.
Okay, so Kobe's bouquet. As the world was set on pause and turned upside down in unison a quarter into 2020, a mirror was cast onto the world's vices. Demons were not shunned, yet they were fed. Distress of character was exploited, and confusion was contradicted by clarity.
So this one?
Yeah.
Yeah.
The work shows the dysfunctional elevator of emotion birthed during this time. The bright colors accompany the dangers of serpents creeping upon beautiful dance floors within struggle. Personal, family, business, political, and social. A struggle nonetheless, all while wanting to return to a familiar place.
I find a bridge, and the bridge for pretty much everything within my work is present time pop culture, mm-hmm. or it's political content of what's going on. Mm-hmm. Because, and how I do that is I take that and I correlate it to the point to where I think about how do we get here?
Yeah.
And then I dig back to, you know, all the way since before slavery sometimes. Mm-hmm. And I say, okay, what similar event happened then to what's going on now?
Yeah.
Because there's a root to everything.
Right, for sure.
So I find that bridge, and the bridge is the aesthetic of the work. Mm-hmm. That's where the art comes into play. It comes from, you know, the colors and just drawing you in. And then a simple reference, which could be something as simple as a taxi cab.
Yeah.
A fragrance bottle.
Mm-hmm.
A cartoon character.
Mm-hmm.
Those things are simple images that give you almost like an innocence.
Right.
And it draws you in, and then
it's approachable.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So once you're pretty much in this realm, because now you're comfortable, now I make you dig a little bit deeper. And the thing about it is, what people have to realize, and I don't really speak about it in its entirety a lot, just because it's something really simple, but the titles are the taxi drivers to the content
right.
of the work.
Right.
And once you read the title, it kind of makes you go back and look at the work all over again.
Right.
And then, you know, with the content, there's the disservative aspect to where it breaks down the painting.
Right.
And then that gives you, it makes the painting almost get bigger.
And so I want to do that. That's something I want to do today with you. Go through every painting, or maybe just a few of the paintings, and talk about the title and how it's relative to the actual work. But before we even get into that, I want you to, you know, tell me a little bit about why Fuego? Why the title Fuego, number one?
Mm-hmm.
I feel like I'm fooling my YouTube audience because I already know. So also something that I don't even think that I mentioned at the beginning is that we've been friends for about 3 years now.
Yeah. Yeah.
And throughout that journey, we've decided to partner, and I manage you. Yeah. And hey, you know, we've been making a good team so far.
we you know, we talked about it the other day, how it just kind of fell into place.
Yeah.
Just how we met and how everything just kind of, even the just the moments where, you know, we were watching, you know, Oprah's Celebrity Ball.
Yeah, for sure.
You know, and yeah. the things that we talk about from music to, even though I don't like disco, and I know you love
disco. Oh, I love disco. They don't know that. Oh my God. They don't know the real me.
I can't stand disco. Oh, but that's the thing. I love Mary J. Blige, and you
I know, love Mary, don't you put that on this camera. Listen, I love Mary J. Blige. But you don't love her like I love her. I love Mary.
You don't love her like I love her. Listen, Mary J. Blige was my first crush when I was 12 years old. I was in the whatever grade.
Yeah. You don't want to put it out
no,
there.
No, I don't.
Look, I love Mary. Let's not do that. Okay, I'm here for Mary. But Fuego means fire in Spanish.
So when COVID hit, I was coming off of my biggest show to date, my first gallery show. But by that time, I had built the brand Lamonté French to where when I got I was blessed to have a gallery show at Winston Contemporary in Rice Village. The buzz was already there for Lamonté French. Mm-hmm. And it was their biggest selling show, and it was my biggest show to date because I sold the most pieces, my most expensive pieces. And then,
so that felt good.
It felt great, but what felt really great was at the private collector's dinner when I sold work. And the work went to some of the most prestigious collections in the world.
Yes.
So, which maybe three or four pieces went to collectors who are in the top 25 collectors in the world.
Yeah, he's not going to tell us who. you know, we talk about it on this channel all the time about how secretive everyone wants to be.
It's just, you know, it's just an exclusive. It's an exclusive club.
Is
you
it?
Know?
Yeah, yeah.
You know, but it. And the thing is, it's not even about the monetary value of it. It's just that people are choosing to live with something for the rest of their lives that
it's personal.
Yeah, that you made. You're putting a piece of you in someone's home, like people that you don't even know.
Yeah.
And then for them to actually connect with it
and interact with it daily.
Exactly.
Yeah.
You know, that's a big deal. So as long as I can just keep making work, you know, that's the most important thing to me.
This represents the major conglomerates that control society. The title of the piece is Tycoon. These are all the contradictions. But then also too, the piece is really arrogant. Because like if you look at his teeth, opulence is represented through like through materialistic things. So that's why he has gold teeth, different colors and things like that. And then you have your historical references like the Bible pages. A reference to slavery up there in the back left corner.
Fuego came from just the lull in all of the minutia that had been put into a bowl during the pandemic.
Yeah.
You know, I dealt with a small bout from depression. You know, I had to find value in certain people. Mm-hmm. And also, too, I had to realize who actually valued and didn't value myself at times from the political undertones that was uproaring with, you know, police brutality and killing these unarmed black men. And and just also, too, when it comes to the content, I try to go as real as I can.
Yeah.
Because I think everyone has to look at things from both sides, and I don't think we always do that. We're not always honest with ourselves.
Yeah.
So,
And when you say that, because I've heard you say that before, looking at things from both sides doesn't mean that one side is negative or positive.
Exactly.
Or that one side is positive or negative.
Yeah, or right or wrong.
Or right or wrong. Yeah. It's just looking at how history has played out and what has put... what has positionally happened to make other things happen.
Yep. And then the thing is the you have to really take it down to the smallest detail. You know, I would always reference and speak about Kanye when he said that slavery was a choice.
Uh-oh.
You know, well, I made a piece I made a piece for my collection Samson Song, which was at Winston Contemporary. It was a Kanye West piece, and I always talk about you have to really understand the heaviness of what that was as a totality from the collars and the atrocities as far as the psychological and then the physical abuse. And then, you know, for a human being not to even be considered as a human. Whole human.
Right.
And then also, too, you know, from pedophilia to, you know, oppressing you, because there were things you have to think about when it's hot outside, right?
Yes.
You're out there and you're like, man, I can't wait to get inside in my AC.
Yeah.
But they didn't have that luxury.
No.
They lived in that also. When they came from out of the fields, they had to go to a cabin where there was no AC.
Yeah.
And then in the harsh winters, snow, all they had was a small fireplace. They lived in the, you know, think about how heavy those things are.
Yeah.
So, you know, but that's just breaking it down all the way to the detail to where you really have to be careful and mindful. And I don't think we are. So everything that is placed into political and social content, entertainment, pop culture, I look at all the way down to the detail from to fashion, you know, to bigger like business conglomerates, and stocks and bonds and trades and things like that.
Yeah.
All of those things correlate along the same line.
Yeah.
And that's what I pour into my work.
Yeah.
Now, the artistic part, as far as the aesthetic comes in, is when I start collaging. You know, I'm meticulous. I sometimes collage with Wall Street Journals. I use hemp cord to where I actually sew into the piece, to the pieces. And, you know, just as recently I started using gold and bronze leaf, just to give it a different aesthetic. And then I worked at an art supply store, so I got to kind of learn the details of certain materials and how they go together and how they'll play on top of each other. So all of this was done during the pandemic.
Right.
And then, you know, when we actually decided to partner up, we put our heads together. And I remember sitting down and I said, you know, Mo, this is what I got planned for 24 months.
Yeah.
And then we just started to check off the box and execute and execute and execute. And, you know, there was a point to where I was kind of, I had found a new space and I was moving to the new studio.
Yeah.
And then I had my creativity had kind of hit a lull and I was just kind of going through the motions. And I remember you told me, you was like, hey, I need you to come with it.
Yeah.
You know, and I remember it messed with me for about.
Yeah, you kept calling me.
Yeah.
Hey, like, Woody, what'd you mean?
Yo, what'd you mean by that? What'd you mean by that?
I'm like, is Lamont calling me again?
And it was the same question every time. Like, and then, you know, and I remember at the time, I think you were trying to spare my feelings. And then it got to a point where I was like, look, Mo, I hired you as my manager because I trust you. I trust you as a curator. I trust you as a consumer, as a collector. But most of all, I trust you as my manager. So I need you to be brutally honest with me.
Yeah, and that's a part of it. That's a part of the partnership. That's a part of the relationship in which we can create a frictionless space.
Yeah.
Where there is definitely going to be friction sometimes.
It is, yeah. You know, because we don't always see eye to eye. But the thing is, also, too, this is something that we're both passionate about.
Yeah.
So, you know, within that, I knew your passion.
Mont and I became friends through Jordan Lee, who I have mad love for. This is while I directed District Art Gallery, as well as served as a founding member. At this show, at Winston, he even put me in one of the works. That was cool. What's even cooler are the bomb-ass times me, him, and Jordan had.
Yeah. Yeah, it's not gonna be
you know, whenever I'm making a collection, I don't cut my hair and I don't shave.
Right.
But I added a more spiritual standpoint this time. I only eat between 7 and 9. That's AM and PM. And then also, too, I stopped my vices during this time period, too.
Okay.
And it just, the work just blossomed.
Yeah.
I remember, I didn't see you for a couple months just because we kept missing each other and we kept missing our meeting time. But, you know, we
did everything. A couple weeks.
Was it a couple weeks?
A couple weeks.
It could have been.
It was like 2 weeks.
No, I didn't.
You said a couple months. There's no way.
It might have been like.
3 weeks.
It might have been 3 weeks.
At the most.
It may have been a month. It may have been a month. But the next time you came to the studio, you were like, wow. Because I had just literally locked myself.
In the studio.
I wasn't taking calls. The only thing I was leaving to was to go around the corner to get a soda, come back, and paint.
Yeah.
And it was 24/7.
Yeah.
And this collection, it just blossomed. You know, I actually was able to diligently sit down and write down my frustrations and my emotions and everything that I had gone through at that time, the past 12 months.
And did you pour that into your work?
Oh, most definitely.
So frustrations.
Frustrations would probably be just from everything being mundane. And then, you know, from a personal standpoint, I had got to a point in my career to where the momentum had started to pick up. I had signed with a new gallery. Yeah. The gallery was picking up momentum.
Yeah.
My name had started to be put in certain circles that I was proud of.
Yes.
And all of that came to a halt.
Yeah.
So
pandemic did that for so many people.
And, you know, for what I do, it's a business. You know, that's how I run my business. So I didn't have any revenue. So I was blessed enough to continue to sell work off of my brand and my name, but it just wasn't anything flowing. And
yeah.
But the gallery, they had built me a studio. I was the first artist in residence.
Yeah.
So all of these things that were lined up, they had to get shut down.
Yeah.
And then,
wow.
And then the heavy thing was I lost a good friend of mine who was attached to the gallery, my friend David Black,
yeah.
who was co-owner of Winston Contemporary. He passed away.
Yes.
And we had become really close just because of our relationship with artists in residence and gallery owner and just things that, you know, just being there and being a part of him and Kevin's family.
Yeah.
You know, so dealing with that, and then also too being a father and having to have these tough conversations with, at the time, my 14, 15 year old son.
Yes.
And, you know, explaining to him why certain things are going on.
Right.
In America or just in society.
Right.
So it was just a
heavy time.
Yeah. It was just a compile of things. And yes. Then, like I said, I actually got COVID.
Yeah.
And then, you know, dealing with that to where I was really isolated, but not by choice this time.
Yeah. I mean, I don't mean it's not laughable.
But that's the thing. It plays on your mental. You know, our freedoms in being able to do what we want and move around how we want, we take those things for granted so much.
Right.
And then when that's...
This wasn't a thing.
Right, exactly.
We were in complete isolation.
Exactly, exactly. I remember stepping outside of my studio and looking outside and literally there was no cars moving, going by. For hours on end, it was just, and you know me, I love the city. I love being from Houston and the heartbeat of it and the energy, and everything was dead.
Yeah.
You know, it's almost like you couldn't even see the stars.
Yeah.
You know,
some people thrived in that solitude. A lot of people had I know I had moments alone that were flourishing to where I am today.
Mm-hmm.
But in that moment, they felt very hard to break through. Mm-hmm. Just like so many people, I lost a lot of people. But it propels you into this beautiful space. I know if I were still creating, I don't know. There's no telling what you come up with in that time of solitude. You're here.
Yeah.
It's just here. So I wanted.
I had literally hit a wall.
Yeah.
To where I didn't. I think I had started collaging.
Yeah.
Just to get my flow back.
Yeah, for sure.
You know, I had went back to my days when I wasn't. I was kind of trying to find myself as an artist.
Again.
And I had learned some things under my mentor. And I went back to that.
Mm-hmm.
And even making work that had no content. That's how I came up with the collection Complex Daydreams.
Right. Which I loved.
Yeah. And
it's all gone.
They're all gone. So when Winston closed down, I was supposed to show that collection at Winston at the Annex, the smaller gallery that they opened. But when they closed down, I put that collection on the market. And they sold all 25 original pieces. Well, almost. I think I only have 4 left, but they sold within a matter of months. But I just couldn't. I didn't have a space to where I couldn't see the light.
Right.
You know, and everything was just dull. So that's when I got a new studio, got some new energy. I called you and was like, Mo, you know, this stuff is gonna shut down, but we gotta hit the ground running.
Any growth. You can't be ready for it because it's growth. It's going to be new. It's going to be new. You're going to have a new life. You're going to be a new person.
Depending on the type of human you are and your life circumstances, your adversities will either push you further or make you stagnant. My adversities, Lamont's adversities, oftentimes push us further.
Right. You know, will you?
When it opens back up, we got to be ready.
Yeah. Yeah. So, you know, you decided that, you know, you would rock with me. And, you know, we kind of took a chance on each other.
Yeah.
You know, I know this was totally new for you.
Yeah.
And just kind of, you know, where I had came from.
Yeah.
In that space.
I mean, it was new, but like, it was new to focus on one artist.
Mm-hmm.
You know, coming from more so of the gallery world, it was like a multitude of artists to focus on at once.
But you were doing your thing though. You were still putting out work. You had made those pieces about the pandemic.
Yeah, those are cool.
And then
those are fun. Kept my mind off of the anxiety of what was happening.
But even when you were starting to put out the knowledge, like the tidbits of pieces of just about the art world and the art market.
Yeah.
I was like, okay, Mo, she's switching it up.
Yeah.
And then when you curated Red Gen for Kobe Deal.
Oh, that's
when I was like, yo.
Yeah.
We got lock in.
Yeah, man. I love Kobe. And I thank him for doing
Kobe's
that.
A genius,
he's
man.
A genius. And hopefully I can share him with, you know, but. Yeah. Is that I needed that, and I needed Kobe in that moment, and I needed you in this moment to kind of reboot, you know, like reboot this energy within this art world. And it's
for me, what's been rewarding is, you know, I know we've been friends for these past 2 or 3 years, and we talk a lot about my process and where I pull from and things like that, but you actually got to see works
from start to finish.
Like you see me sit on the couch and mumble to myself and gaze off and you not know if I'm listening to you. And then all of a sudden in 14 days, you look at the canvas and it's totally different.
It's totally different.
Yeah.
And that's definitely been a pleasure. The first piece I seen you start on was trap music and all that jazz. Mm-hmm. And that's, you know, I'm fighting people for that one right now.
He was like, I want it.
I wanted it from the moment that it was just yellow and pink on the canvas because of the positioning, the composition of those two colors and how they interact with one another. And so the moment that I seen, and I know like their position just like this, the moment that I was able to see those two colors, and then when you started to go, and I'm telling your process right now because I was watching.
No, that's okay.
But when you got your oil stick, I believe, and you started to just go
music,
on top of it with the stanzas, and I was like, I said, Lamont, you're gonna look at the notes because it's the notes to Miles Davis kind of blue, and that meant so much to me because that's my grandfather's favorite song, and that was his favorite album, and that song.
That album, it changed the dynamics in the cortex of jazz music.
Yeah.
And what a lot of people don't understand is that
I have on my grandfather's pants right now. Isaiah hates when I wear his pants.
There you go. And, you know, kind of blue. That's my, you know, Miles Davis is my favorite artist.
Yeah.
So
period.
It just in any type of creativity, he's my favorite artist.
Yes.
But you know, people don't know he didn't write sheet music. He just played.
Yeah.
And that's what that piece, even the reference to baking soda, and you know, the piece is about addiction.
Yes.
But when you think of jazz music, you don't think about addiction. Mm-hmm. But most jazz musicians during the 50s, 60s, and 70s, they were addicted to heroin.
Yeah.
And that was their drug of choice because it could stretch, not necessarily their creativity, but they could stay up longer.
Right.
It would give them more energy.
Right.
So, you know.
That's such a drug.
Yeah.
I mean, I couldn't imagine, actually. I couldn't even imagine seeing somebody. You know, the closest I've been to heroin was on television. Watching, I know if I see a spoon pop up on TV.
And a syringe,
and,
you know.
And it's like, but that time period, it's interesting that, you know, that we correlate this creativity and this stretch creativity with drugs and with addiction. Mm-hmm. And your addictions can be anything.
Mm-hmm.
And so in that piece in particular is, you know, when they'll see your work, but that piece in particular, it started off very simple, and then you started to layer and layer and layer and layer. Mm-hmm. And what I like to tell people when they look at that piece is you got to think of it like what is the jazz is
scattered
jazz, because that's what, even though the stanza behind it is kind of blue, which is a very monotone.
Mm-hmm.
And so if you think about that piece like music, it's like, here's this peaceful song that really relaxes you, that really puts you at peace. Mm-hmm. But here on top of it is all of this chaos.
Yeah.
And
that's my work in general.
Yeah.
Is that there's so many layers, and it's almost like I said, I always tell people I'm painting my dreams.
Yeah.
But I study jazz musicians because of composition.
Yes.
Because I have all these different ideas. You have to understand, in jazz music, they're playing music that does not have words. Mm-hmm. And even if they're in a video, mm-hmm. they are the visual mm-hmm. with this instrument. Mm-hmm. So it has to all make sense. Mm-hmm. It has to tell a story. So I have to make this piece tell a story from left to right to where it flows, but I have all these different images.
Right.
And sometimes, even with that, you have to simplify it also.
Yeah.
Because the images are so large, yeah. which brings me to Jonas Tycoon.
Okay.
And
which is, again, I don't mean, that piece, before you go into it, that piece to me, you know, Danielle and we had a moment with that piece.
Yeah.
Because
yeah.
I don't know what we were listening to. It might have been the music.
Then, it we were listening to jazz music, and then I switched it to Jeezy.
You switched it to Jeezy. Yeah, yeah. Okay. So you switched
and
it to Jeezy.
And she like looked at it a whole different way. Yeah.
And isn't that like, that's crazy how the elements, how the, you know, the elements around you can change how you receive something. Yeah. And it almost makes me like want to throw a Jeezy song on at the exhibition.
Hey, Thug Motivation 101 is the best Jeezy album ever.
What?
Man, Dope Boys Go Crazy is my favorite song.
That's when you put Jeezy on while we was looking at that piece. I already thought the piece was arrogant, but after that, I
probably
seen
should tell
it.
People like what.
Oh yes, go ahead.
The basis of the piece is it's on a 8-foot by 4-foot cardboard. It's a giant blue whale with gold teeth.
Yeah. And they're going to see it. It's going to pop up.
Yeah. I mean, it's just a piece to where, you know, I was digging into it, and then it got to a point to where I was like, it was really, really simple compared to most of my work.
Yeah.
And I remember you saw it and you were like, this is it.
Yeah.
Like, this is it.
And that was it.
And it was, now this is before I added the words or just maybe the hemp cord, but I added maybe 2 or 3 more touches and it's so simple because the image is mm-hmm. so heavy.
And the color
is so large. Yeah.
So bold.
Yeah. So it kind of speaks for itself. So then Danielle, she described it as being arrogant.
Yeah.
An arrogant piece.
Yeah.
And it becomes about the gold teeth and the names that you see that go down. I don't want to give the names away.
Well, that the piece to me is it's kind of Houston. It feels like Houston to me.
It's just really the pieces about icons that have come victim to their own demise mm-hmm. through what we would say are vices that are demons, mm-hmm. but yet we still hold them immortal because they're still gods.
Ooh, that's heavy. What are the words? There's some words on that piece.
I'll give you some because there's a couple parts I want people to see when they come to the show.
Yeah.
Is like tolerate.
Yeah.
Intolerant.
Yeah.
Because they are pronouns that are based on the same thing. It's basically the same word, but if you take a few letters out, mm-hmm. they go to different spectrums.
Yeah.
And that's how the divide is within society now.
Yeah. So we got into trap music and all that jazz. Mm-hmm. We got into Jonas Tycoon. Mm-hmm. You have a piece called What If I Was White? Mm-hmm. Which is also one of my favorites. It's one of those pieces you have to spend a lot of time with, kind of moving around it. And can you talk about that piece a little bit?
So it's a piece that I made on the color palette of black. Mm-hmm. And what people have to understand is those hues, I learned this from Kerry James Marshall, by the way, there's different hues of black. Mm-hmm. So you can almost create a hologram.
Right.
So it has references to just anything within society, from political undertones, even to a personal standpoint. So in my opinion, when you go to the hood, you see a liquor store, mm-hmm. might be your mom and pop liquor store, beer, wine, liquor, that's what you see on there.
Right.
But then on the opposite corner or 2 blocks down, you also see a church.
Yeah, always.
So it has a reference to where you see beer, wine, and liquor, and it's in black, and then there's a church standing right on top in the middle of beer, wine, liquor.
Yeah.
And then it goes into some educational references, even, you know, it's collage with the vintage Bible pages, which references the strong, heavy undertones of religion and control of religion. Because now you have to look at the religion, the religious institutions that we have now, the mega churches.
It's funny. It's crazy that you call them institutions.
That's what they are.
Yeah.
Because the thing is, and it goes back to historical references, you know, the Bible says come as you are. But a lot of people that are in these religious realms or whatnot, they don't really, they make the Bible make sense. I call them convenient Christians.
Yeah.
So what I do is I take these same references and I put them in their face and I make them analyze them.
Yeah.
And then even like a reference to probably the greatest lyricist that, you know, from hip hop music that I've ever known, the reference to Nas's Illmatic album. That's what, when I was making this piece, that's what I was listening to.
Yeah.
So I did the actual artwork in the same font that it is on the LP.
Yeah. And there's also remnants of a flag.
Yeah, the American flag. So you're going to see the American flag in a lot of my work, probably 75% of my work. That was actually my first muse.
Yeah.
But it's not, I take the flag and I chop it up and I give it an aesthetic, again, to where it makes you feel comfortable, and then I give it a deeper content.
Right.
Because I feel like we live in the greatest country in the world, but we take its liberties and freedoms for granted, and we abuse them.
Right.
So when I put the flag in works, it's always to drive you to the content.
Right.
So.
Because it's familiar.
Exactly.
And so you have a piece. I'm not going to mess up the name.
Oh.
you have a piece that you put a flag in all of your shows.
Uh-huh.
Right. All of your exhibitions.
Yep.
And in this, we were talking about the flag that's in this show, and I don't remember who it was, but they called it, there was like, they looked at it and they said, man, this is an emotional piece. And you feel that when you look at it, it's heavy. What's the name of that piece?
So the title of the piece is What You Really Know About the Dirty South, Confederate Undertones, The Truth of an Ugly Nation. And what
can you tell us that one more time?
What You Really Know About the Dirty South.
Yeah.
Confederate Undertones.
Yes.
The Truth of an Ugly Nation.
Yes. And I want to remind everybody that the titles are
the taxi drivers to the content.
Yeah.
Okay. So the piece specifically is an American flag. So when I make my flags, sometimes I cut them in half, sometimes I give you a glimpse of them or whatnot, but it's always the same pattern, which is, it's the pattern of the 50 stars and the 13 stripes.
Yes.
Because I'm going to, this flag is not going to be what you think it is, but if it's an official flag, if it has 50 stars and 13 stripes.
Right.
So you could be in an emergency standpoint to where you have to salute a flag.
Mm-hmm.
And if that flag is there, whether you believe in it or not,
right,
it's law, you have to salute it.
Right.
Which means you have to respect it.
Right.
Whether you believe in my perspective or not,
yeah,
if I'm white or black, you're going to have to respect me for what I stand on.
Right.
So the flag is like a mirror to me.
Mm-hmm.
So it's a official flag. It has 50 stars and 13 stripes. The 13th stripe is the bottom of a Confederate flag.
Right.
And then it's sewn into and it's stitched all over the flag to represent the divide of what the country started off as. That's the foundation of America, is the divide.
Yeah.
Because of the Civil War.
Foundation is the divide.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Because of the Civil War.
How do you even continue in a structured manner?
Exactly.
After that.
Exactly. So the stitching represents where we are today. And then you can see it has bloodshed going down the flag, and then it has burned bushels of cotton,
right,
on all over the flag.
And it's crazy it's crazy to me, because it goes back to the beginning of our conversation when we were talking about how you're tying the past, the present, and the future, because that's all in that flag. How it started on this cracked foundation, how it's progressed into
where we are today.
Where we are today, mm-hmm. which is still
the same thing.
A cracked foundation mm-hmm. to where in.
But also too, the importance of the flag to me is the Confederate flag being the 13th stripe.
Right.
Because it.
Don't
it,
forget.
Exactly.
Don't forget.
Don't, because you're taking them down.
Yeah.
Or because you've allowed us to have a black president. Or, you know, there's some, or a black female vice president.
Right.
Don't forget why we, what the foundation of this country is.
Right.
It is turmoil.
Even
it
in is this a divide. And even in this conversation, Lamont, a bill was passed in Texas yesterday that does not allow teachers to teach about racism in the classroom.
Yeah, I saw that.
You cannot, it is against the law, if I'm not mistaken, to teach racism, to talk about, not to teach racism, uh-huh. but to talk about racism within the classroom. Mm-hmm. And it almost seems like, even politically, I've been seeing a few things, it almost seems like an attempt to erase the idea mm-hmm. that it exists or that it ever
but
did.
But see, that's the thing about art, because you're expressing yourself.
Right.
So the thing is, the piece is so beautiful.
Yeah.
But it's so ugly in its undertones.
Yeah.
So
it carries an energy.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So even if you don't believe in the American flag,
yeah.
if you don't believe in the Confederate flag, you have to respect the piece. And not just the piece, but you also have to respect the flag.
In the moment that we are, and I think that's the heavy part of it, of at any moment, if we have to salute the flag,
You have to respect the foundation of what it is.
You have to respect every part of what it
exactly,
is.
Exactly.
And wow.
So yeah. And then cotton was the first number one revenue within America, mm-hmm. I guess you could say. And then going back to the titles being the taxi drivers of the content.
Yeah.
The title, What You Really Know About the Dirty South, that was from Goody Mob's they had a song called The Dirty South
mm-hmm.
on their debut album, Cell Therapy.
Mm-hmm.
Goody Mob derived from the rap group Outkast and the Dungeon Family at LaFace Records during the early 90s.
Mm-hmm.
And that was one of, they were talking about the projects, and they were the first ones to start talking about the trap
mm-hmm.
and what was going on within the South and the society of what they were living in.
Mm-hmm.
And also too, Atlanta was a Confederate state.
Mm-hmm.
So Confederate undertones, that goes to the Confederate flag being the foundation and the layer of what the American flag was built upon.
Yeah.
And then yeah. the truth of an ugly nation.
And you're taking these images and you're bringing us in, like
exactly.
you said, and
exactly.
now we're going to have this ugly conversation
exactly.
of what it really is. Mm. But those are the pieces. Those are my favorite pieces. Those I have dibs on them. But they will be on my website.
You can get all of them.
How much is it gonna cost me?
Look, you know, but she get a percentage of the work, you know, so she get a bigger discount than everybody.
I really want them to check out the work throughout us talking. You know, they're popping up. They're able to see them. I wish that everyone lived in Houston so we could all, you know, see it on June 11th. But, you know, Fuego's been a special project. I've watched you grow a lot.
I'd like to know, what has been your favorite part about putting this collection together?
Spending the time, getting back into the groove of spending the time with artists.
Mm-hmm.
And you're an artist that I don't mind spending time with. Some, you know, it gets a little crazy,
yeah.
But
we have fun. And then, you know, it gets serious sometimes too, you know, because
yeah.
this is, you know, we're both passionate about what we do. So
yeah, and you know, I tell you, I can't write in your studio, and so a lot of the writing that I do is thinking about the work. And you know, I call you sometimes. I'm like, Lamont, what do you think about putting this work here? Or what mm-hmm. do you know? I called you about the flag the other mm-hmm. day because. It's the process, my best part is thinking about the work
mm-hmm.
and thinking about how special it is to be a part of someone who I think is very special, especially in this art,
mm-hmm.
in this art ecosystem that I 100% see going above and beyond what I think you even expected
within
this art world.
6 years ago, I definitely didn't expect to be here.
Yeah.
Where I'm at and the plays and the moves that
yeah.
You know, my name is being discussed in. But it was it was what I had dreamed of. I just didn't think it was going to happen this fast.
Yeah, and it takes that diligence, and it takes change.
Yeah.
And, you know, as an artist, I've seen you grow a lot. And I think that's what I said. I think that was a part of our conversation. Yeah. You know, mm-hmm. that was a part of our conversation mm-hmm. because we talked about that. And that's something that has to happen continuously, is that continuous push through.
Yeah.
Push through the spin,
An artist has to, I think, not just hold yourself accountable, but you have to have someone that holds you accountable.
Yeah.
You know, as far as, you know, potential is just what you could be.
Yeah.
You know, but if you can't execute and elevate and, you know, and take your dark moments and use them as fuel.
Right.
You know, you have to find where that light switch is.
Yeah. The work is fire. It's, you know, when people describe things with one word, mm-hmm. sometimes I'm like, can you give me more?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. My collection at Winston was Samson's song.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, but for anybody to say, oh, the work is fire, or, you know, I think that's important. I think you guys, y'all make sure y'all follow Lamont on Instagram. It's French_Lamont, because that you guys are going to be able to see his process throughout the years of him exploring who he is as an artist. And it changes over and over and over again for all of the artists that we know. And if you watch this channel, if you watch this YouTube, you guys, I know you guys undeniably like to see artists grow. And you like to understand the trajectory of art. Lamont did not go to school. He was not classically trained.
Yeah. And I'm a self-taught artist. My degree is actually in psychology.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, but I think that your degree being in psychology is, that plays a major part.
Yeah, it does.
And it speaks to who you are. Mm-hmm. It speaks to the content that you put within your work. Mm-hmm. I think that you think heavily about your content, and then you have a different process than a lot of artists. Mm-hmm. And I think it's sometimes difficult for people to understand that process. Mm-hmm. You have a lot to say, mm-hmm. but you have a lot to say about things that have actually already been said. You're mm-hmm. just like, let me tell you again. Yeah. You know what I mean? And let me tell you all, let me tell you this story, this idea, this, let me tell you this, let me give you a history lesson.
That's exactly what it is. Because I don't want you to forget.
Don't forget. Yeah. And then now you live with it. Mm-hmm. And something that I tell people when they're looking at your work is, if you take it home, it's a conversation that you're going to have. Yeah.
You're gonna have to have a cocktail party at your house. And it's probably going to be the center of attention.
But you're going to have a conversation with the work over and over and mm-hmm. over again. It's going to be dialogue between you and the work. Over and over again.
And for me, the my biggest reward when I'm making the work is listening to the canvas talk to me and tell me. And, you know, this collection is a lot brighter than most of my past works.
Yeah, it is.
Just to give a different aesthetic and me coming out of those dark spaces when I was making this work.
Yeah. So. And so
I'm really proud of this collection.
Yeah, so I am too.
Yeah, I can't wait for the show. And
June 11th, Sandman Studios. Yeah. Some of the people that are sponsoring the exhibition, we did something at Day Six Coffee.
Yeah, Day Six Coffee
last week. You have
Uncle Nearest Whiskey, Deep Eddie's Vodka.
Yeah,
my boy Warren Luckett at Brand War Wines.
Yeah,
he's the head of Black Restaurant Week.
Yeah.
Who else? And you know, biggest thing is just the space. You know, shout out to Stevie at Sandman Studios for just partnering with us and letting us use the venue. You know, we're gonna turn a warehouse into a gallery for a day and a half.
Yeah.
And you know, these shows, you have to understand too. I like to put on exhibitions.
Yeah.
Which is the entire experience to it. So you know, you have a couple drinks and then you'll go back and look at the piece for a third time, and it'll get even bigger.
Yeah. You know? So. Hopefully by that time, there's a red dot next to it.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. And you'll spend some money.
Now you missed out on it. Yes. Hey, come to the exhibition, come to the show. Yeah,
that's another thing. So these are 10 pieces. They're at a fraction of my normal prices. The reason I did that is because I wanted people to be able to touch me again, my collectors, the consumers, and then even art lovers. You know, it might be your first time coming to an exhibition or coming to a Lamonté French exhibition, but I want people to actually have this work in their homes. Now, this is the only time that these works are going to be at these prices, but, you know, it's, again, me just reaching back out and saying, hey, you know, it's good to see you again.
Yeah, I mean, connecting with the people. Mm-hmm. Like, allowing that connectability to happen all over again, yeah. You know. I'm excited. I'm glad that they're at a fraction of the price for myself.
They're always at a fraction of the price for you.
And that's why you got to have relationships with artists. No, I'm kidding. So I'm excited. I'm glad that we had this conversation.
Yeah, this is dope. This is what we need. You know, just in the art world, people actually given a platform for artists to be able to explain and talk about themselves. You know, that's therapeutic.
Too. Yeah, because that's what everyone's always trying to figure it out. Yeah. They're always, what does this mean? What does this mean? What does this mean? It's always a question. And, you know, something that I know a lot of people tell people is, what's your perspective? Think about your perspective first, mm-hmm. You know, but that's the importance of also having an artist book. Little segue. Having an artist book. We're working on an artist book right now for Fuego. Mm-hmm.
For the collection.
For the collection. And it hopefully will be print to copy.
Yeah.
By the time June 11th.
And if not, you can still purchase it. And then we will order it and get it to you.
Yeah. And that's something that... That's something that you guys can...
That's not me barking.
That's something that I'm excited for people to enjoy. Yes. Because there are elements in that book that's not going to be at Fuego.
Yeah.
You know, from some of your dissertations, things that you've written about your own work.
And journals and stuff like
that. Yeah, and your champagne toast that not too many people know about. they can get a little crazy, but I think it speaks to your humor. Mm. And I think this is the last thing I'm going to say, because sometimes I think that people look at your work and they think it's so serious, mm-hmm. all of the time, but a lot of your work is witty.
It's really just me trolling.
Yeah, because you're a troll.
Yeah. See, now I'm a troll.
You a troll. No,
but yeah. it's my humor, and then it's, you know, these simple things that we take for granted and we walk right past them every day, but that, you know, they speak in volumes.
Yeah.
And it's just, you know, just making you look at things a little bit different. I think if people looked at things differently, sometimes not to see if something's right or wrong, but just look at it a little bit differently.
Yeah.
It'll change the whole dynamic.
Absolutely.
Of what's going on.
So it's been a pleasure.
Right on.
Hey, you know, if you vibe, subscribe. That's my saying. Subscribe if you vibe.
Yeah, that sounds like a commercial.
yeah, right. So I'm excited. I'm glad that we got to have this conversation, Lamont. Hopefully.
We still gonna sing the R&B songs, because, you know, I like the mic.
Before we press record.
We're not doing disco. We're not doing disco.
Before we press record, we had a whole moment.
We sang Jagged Edge.
Yeah, I mean.
Together. He Can't Love You. That's a classic song.
Yeah. And don't start singing it, because that's not what they're here for.
But see, the classic is Mary J. Blige, You Remind Me.
Okay. I love Mary J.
Listen, that's my boo.
So, hey.
That's my boo.
You find her. You find her and you make her yours.
Mary been through some stuff. She been through some
stuff. Don't put her through nothing else.
I wouldn't.
I don't know, though. She make good sad music, though.
That My Life album, man.
Okay.
We got to get out of here.
People be showing their age.
Man, see.
You know, but again, it was a pleasure. You know, we dabbing. What we doing? It's here.
This is so corny. That is so corny.
All right, so like I always tell y'all, be safe in these streets. That's what I tell them, Lamont.
Be healthy.
Be healthy. No, seriously, you guys, I can't wait for y'all to see this exhibition. We worked so long on this. Lamont has done all of the physical work. and the mental work, really. I've just been here. But seriously, we've worked so hard on this exhibition. Curating it has been and will continue to be a pleasure throughout until June 12th.
Yeah, so June 12th. Artist Talk is that Saturday at 1 o'clock. And come out and prepare yourself to buy some art. You know, you're getting a major artist, major large scale work at a decent price. So add some good work to your collection.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. And you guys know about, we talk about collections all day here. So you guys already know. But you guys stay safe. We're going to have a Jagged Edge duo here in a second.
Yeah.
We're not going to burden you guys with that. But we're out. Lamont, thank you.
Right on. Thank you, Mo.
All right.
There you go.
My guys! You in there?